Greetings, everyone. Thank you. Greetings, nerds, geeks, gamers, gators, people of interest. This is welcome to BadgerPod Gamergate, number 21. Damn, I missed it by just one. Nerd Revolt. I'm your host, Brian Martinez, and I'm joined with Allison, Panina, and Rachel, and we will have more panelists coming on, hopefully, soon.
But, yeah, hopefully they remember that they said they would come on.
Yeah, so, but yeah, we do have a show, and we're going to go through with it, and it should be good. We have a lot to talk about. So,
And if they don't show up, we'll just get better for them.
Yeah. So,
Where's the end of
it? You.
Are we doing any mailbag stuff or anything before we start, or are we just going to jump in?
Yeah, of course we're going to have a mailbag. All right, I think the echo is coming from Brian.
I'll mute myself.
All right.
Yes.
All right, so let's do the mailbag.
Woot.
The Swede. Hi, the badge of Honey Badgers. This show was really coming into the nitty-gritty. Anna's topic of free speech and the law and more should, in my opinion, really be a whole show. Anna said a lot of true things about men, which Karen graciously agreed to. Smiley asterisk. Thanks, the Swede. I believe he's referring to the previous show. Was it Gamergate that we started to talk about free speech? It was probably Gamergate or the Gamergate show or the Thursday show. But thanks for writing in, Swede, and giving us your thoughts, as it were.
Yeah, I believe that was the Thursday show.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, in which case, this is a letter that snuck into the wrong mailbag. So I shall move on. Dynasty Star has made an inquiry. Recently, in the most recent podcast, Gamergate and the Badger Cave, you said you share channels to shill. Actually, that was two podcasts ago, but regardless. I wanted to shill a couple channels that I don't know if you know about. The first channel I'd like to shill is... Oh my goodness, I'm going to mispronounce this. Syria? Sarah? C-E-A-R-A McCord. Oh,
that's Ciara Cord. She's got a radio. Yeah, she's got a good channel.
Okay, yeah, Ciara Cord. You think you'd all get along with her. She used to be a feminist, but has since woken up to the narrative and does a lot of videos opposing feminism. Her YouTube channel can be found at, just look up Ciara McCord, C-E-A-R-A-M-A-M-C-C-O-R-D. Another channel I think you'd like is Video Culture Replay. She does a lot of Gamergate videos and on some occasions speaks out against social justice warriors, but for the most part focuses on ethical concerns. Here's one of my favorite videos by her. I can't give you the name of that because it's just a link. So go to since this is a shout-out, go check out Video Culture Replay. Go back to the live letter. Another channel, Gamergate channel, that I'd like to shill is QQ. He focuses exclusively on ethical concerns, but he does a lot of Gamergate recaps. I don't know if you want to shill him, but I thought I'd try. So that's the third channel, QQ. It's Q-U, Q-U. So if you're interested in pure gamer goober gator Gamergate recaps, then apparently that's the channel to go to. Well, thanks for doing those shout-outs, Dynasty Star. If you have a shout-out that you want us to shout-out, just send them to topic@badgerpod.com, and we'll do our best I'll do my best not to mispronounce things too much and give them a shout-out. From Jesse, please talk about God of War 3, guys. Kratos kills so many gods in brutal ways, and that sex scene with Aphrodite is the stuff of legends. All right. Well, sure, I'm sure we could talk about God of War 3 at some point. Mr. 303 also writes, Hi, Badgers. I have a couple of suggestions for eventual game review show. God of War. Most people see the protagonist, Kratos, as just a blood-hungry monster that is out to cause chaos and destruction, but I think there's more to him. In a way, he's the embodiment of the so-called toxic masculinity, angry, violent, and having the occasional threesome. Can Kratos be summarized as a typical male power fantasy, or is there something not so obvious about his character? I haven't actually played the game, so I can't answer that question, but has anyone here played God of War?
A little bit.
I have. Yeah, I played God of War. I played them all, actually.
They're good games.
I I think that I don't know if I would go so far as to call it toxic masculinity, but I do think that it's hyper masculinity. It's almost like to the point where it's a bit of a parody of itself. Like, not in the way that Duke Nukem is, where you know that he's intentionally ridiculous, but it's sort of like it's overkill. But when the guy who created the God of War series, his name is David Jaffe. He's one of my favorite game developers because he's very honest to the point where he uses foul language without even thinking about it. And I don't know, he's just a really cool dude. Basically, he was like, I wanted to make the bloodiest and most extreme game that I could, while at the same time maintaining like the epic violence and action that I always thought of when I thought of ancient Greek mythology, which is what God of War's, existed in the world. And the main character, while small in comparison to all the stuff that he's dealing with, is supposed to be essentially like taking on all these things that are much larger than he is and stronger and everything, and he gives no fucks the whole time. And the fact that he's incredibly brutal to his enemies is just sort of like reflecting, Greek mythology. So I guess God of War is as toxically masculine as someone might think of ancient Greek mythology being. So if, because that's what he's reflecting, except that, he wanted to, David Jaffe just wanted to really make it stand out in that way. Actually, it was his work with God of War that kind of like made the QuickTime event, which is basically the process where an event in the game that involves you pressing certain buttons in sequence according to instruction will lead to the death of a certain enemy or accomplishing a certain task. But in God of War, they do it really well. So that would be something that we could certainly get into if you guys wanted to, because I have a lot of experience with God of War, and I love that game series too.
That isn't his last suggestion, but we could definitely give that a try. God of War, since you seem to have a lot of background with it, Brian.
Yes, I certainly could.
I watch a lot of it being played. It's really awesome. I wish I could play it.
Okay, so the second suggestion is The Last of Us. This is a very highly regarded game, which on paper sounds very conventional, a third-person survival game set in zombie apocalypse. What makes it stand out is the great story and the intriguing characters. It would be an interesting discussion what role gender and sexuality plays in the world and what are the differences with its DLC Left Behind. Has anyone played The Last of Us?
I did, yes, again. I'm actually replaying it for the fourth time right now.
Jesus, Brian.
I really like that game. The Last of Us is awesome. And it's really, I don't normally, when it comes to games that aren't RPGs specifically, I don't normally give a whole lot of lip service to the story, at least not as much as many people do. Like, I think that when it comes to the game story, if it's not an RPG, I don't think it's ultimately really important that it's really, really well done. And I think that I tend to focus more on the gameplay in those cases. And The Last of Us is, at its core, it's a stealth game, and it has action in it and survival elements and horror elements and stuff. But it's really like a stealth game at its core. And it has a really good story, really, really good performances, and you just get sucked right in. But yeah, I can certainly talk a lot about The Last of Us. And they do some stuff with sexuality and gender in it, in the story, that I think they handle better than any other video game I've ever seen. But when they do the DLC, though, I don't like it as much. They take a step into the eye-rolly. But, like, the main core, yeah, very well done. I can certainly talk about that sometime if you guys want.
I haven't actually, I've done a bit of The Last of Us. Like, I haven't actually played it. I just watched my husband playing it because I'm a freak. I just like watching other people play games. I did play games. I don't talk about those times. Anyway, so but I thought it was the characters were certainly very engaging and a different take on them, on the concept, like the archetypes. So sure, what I would do is I'd probably take another look at the game itself, and maybe play some of it myself, and see where that takes me. If I disappear completely from everybody, like from Honey Badger Radio, you'll know that a game got me. So.
don't worry about a search and rescue party. Just go see if Allison is in her living room.
Yeah, no, I just yeah. I'll blame this show for making me fall off the wagon. Anyway. All right, next one. Wolfenstein: The New Order, featuring another hyper-masculine protagonist. I think this game had a great post-war feel, even in an alternative history setting. There's a variety of interesting characters in there, including some contrasting females like Anya Oliwa, Carolyn Becker, and Irene Engel, capable of both good and evil, courage and malice. Regardless, if you decide to discuss them, the above are some great games that I can recommend. Best wishes, Mr. 0303. What do you guys think?
Guess what?
You played it?
I played that game, yeah. and it was really good. Yeah, Wolfenstein New Order was a lot of fun to play. But do you think it's a little bit strange that we are, like, when we look at a game that has, because I'm thinking about Wolfenstein, but I'm also thinking about the other two, when people say, well, I think this game is a really good example of, you know, of strong female characters. You know what I think a really good example of that is? It's when you don't really notice. It's when you don't really say, this is a really good example, but you're just like, wow, I like that game. And there might have been males in it, and there might have been females in it, and you just didn't stand out in any way. They were just sort of like, you saw them as people, as individuals, and not as male, female, you know, whatever. So I don't know, I'm just thinking about that out loud, I guess. But.
As in, the game does a really good job at actually pulling you in to the story, making the characters relatable, that you don't seem to notice anything particularly wrong that you have to sit there and point at it as an example. It does everything right, where it keeps you, the game does what it does. It's supposed to do. It captivates you and your attention, and nothing else seems to matter.
Yeah, well, it doesn't, like, this isn't just obviously not limited to games. Like, if you just, any medium, a book that you just read, or a movie you just watched, or a television show that you were sucked into, or a game, where, you know, when everything is said and done, if you enjoyed it, you didn't enjoy it because it had well-written women in it, or a certain number of evil minorities, or any whatever the quota might be, but you were just like, wow, I like that. You know, like, one of my favorite games, my most favorite game series of all time is Mega Man, and Mega Man's all robots, and I don't notice, like, I don't even think about that. Like, I don't even think about the fact that it's all robots, because you don't even see it. You're just playing a game that you like, and I think that that's not whitewashing. I just think that If we get there, that would be nice. So,
right. I mean, it doesn't need to fill a specific quota. It could be, it doesn't matter. Like you were saying, Mega Man is a bunch of robots, and
it's still compelling.
It's still compelling. You even have something such as a game like Flowers, where you're nothing but the wind carrying petals, and that in itself, yes, game is intriguing. It has a very, very minimal story, but it's like as if the story is somewhat revealed as you go through the levels. So you could play as a freaking plant, and it doesn't matter. If the medium is not doing its job in keeping you entertained and providing you with information that you can engage with, whether it is a game, a movie, music, books, whatever, if it's not doing that, then it's not really worth being part of that medium, that criteria for what we find as an engaging piece of art or media or whatever, that if it wasn't for these things, we wouldn't be sitting here talking about them.
Indeed. I'm done with the and you are echoing. I'm done with the mailbag now, Brian, so you can have the show back.
And all right. I will take said show back. So, I don't know. But, yeah, I mean, like, if you guys have any other games that stood out for you, I think this is, you know, still something we can continue to talk about. I love all the games that were mentioned, obviously, because I played them all many times. Except for Wolfenstein. I played that, like, twice, but I really liked it. So we're going to go ahead and get into the first story. Let's start because I want to get into the Gawker thing later. So,
ooh, a wild Oliver has appeared.
Oh, hello.
Good news, everyone. Good news, everyone.
All right. Well, we're going to go into you just got here in time for the first story. So we're going to go ahead, and I'm going to give it to Rachel. We'll start with the Progressive Cartoon newspaper article that I saw that I felt the need to share. So, Rachel, why don't you go ahead and do
I'm going to summarize. So an article came out stating that there are cartoons pushing an LGBTQ progressive agenda, but of those cartoons they mentioned that I've seen, only one has an actual homosexual relationship, which is The Legend of Korra. The writers of this article, like most social justice warriors, only care about the appearance of being progressive and miss the legitimately great things about these shows. And that's really what I wanted to point out. I wrote a little bit of a longer article on this, and to explain what I'm talking about, the shows that they mentioned were Clarence, Legend of Korra, Adventure Time, and Steven Universe. And without going on for too long, I'm going to explain why all of this is kind of bullshit, with the exception of Clarence, which I have not seen, so I can't really speak on. But Legend of Korra, that was something that was kind of tacked on, and you know, you only heard about it towards the end of the show. The other two, it's kind of people sort of skirting around the edge of what you can get away with on television by being really, really subtle, but creating very complex relationships. Adventure Time, the relationship between Princess Bubblegum and Marceline is only hinted at. One could even say that maybe they were just really, really good friends in the past, but we don't know. We have no clue. But that's something that's hinted at as having been something that happened in the past that isn't there anymore, and they just never talk about it. And that's the whole thing, is that they're not talking. They don't interact with each other because something bad happened between them a long time ago, and they don't ever address it. And Steven Universe, and I would ask if it even counts if one of the characters is, well, neither of them are really human, because Marceline's a vampire queen, and the other one is basically sapient bubblegum. I don't know if you can really call that a progressive if there aren't even any humans being involved. And the second situation you have is Steven Universe, which is kind of a thing in and of itself, because what they have done is they've created a race of, and there are characters in the show which are an alien race of anthropomorphic, asexual, genderless gemstones. And so they, because they don't have a gender, them being in relationships together, even though they both use female pronouns, is technically not really a lesbian or homosexual relationship because there's really no gender, so it's kind of just the norm for them. This is probably going over everybody's like, ooh. But the most important thing I think to glean from these cartoons is that what they are doing is they are talking about relationships in a good way. They are pointing out the relationships aren't simple. It's something you have to work at. It's something that needs to be maintained. And they go to great lengths to show what happens after the initial feeling of love and affection and things like that, that there's something else that has to be worked at, and I think that's really good. The other thing that I think may have been done that is intentional or unintentional is that they have managed to create really, really sympathetic male characters. In fact, I would go so far as to say that in Adventure Time and Steven Universe, some of the most sympathetic characters are male characters. And whether intentionally or unintentionally, they are creating empathy for men. A space where people can empathize with male characters and see them as emotional characters who aren't just endlessly stoic. So I don't know. I guess it's progressive in one way, but probably not in the way that they're expecting.
Sorry, Brian. Didn't mean to step on. It's okay. Go on.
So this is the thing that I wanted to throw in there.
Mm-hmm.
The gems in the show, mm-hmm. Steven Universe. I never saw it. I just watched some clips. But mm-hmm. this is something that I think is important to point out. They may have been described as genderless, and I would go so far as to say if that's what they say, then that's what it is. However, when it comes to the kind of people that we're talking about,
mm-hmm.
they tend to cling to whatever they think the most appropriate pronouns would be. So I want to I'll give you an example. When Mighty No. 9 was being developed, okay, by Concept, was basically headed by the guy who used to make the Mega Man games and left Capcom because he didn't like the direction they were going in, and the fact that Capcom hadn't made a Mega Man game in God knows how long that wasn't mm-hmm. still like a little bitty 8-bit one. He decided, I'm going to go and do my own thing, and he started Mighty No. 9, and he started the Kickstarter and got a whole lot of money. And Dina, I believe her name was, basically started talking about making the main character, 9, into a woman. She felt that, you know, the main character should be female. But the weird thing is, just as in the case of what you're talking about with mm-hmm. Steven Universe, Mighty No. 9 is a fucking robot. The robots yes. don't have a gender, so it doesn't really matter. But he's still he is addressed as a he because it appears like a boy. It looks like a boy, so they say it's a boy. And this is and the same thing goes for Mega Man. They call him Mega Man, but it really is just a robot. It doesn't. It's not. It's ungendered. So the same thing I think is the mentality that is going through this with the gems is they're addressing these characters as they're female, and they use female pronouns with each other because, you know, you got to use your preferred pronouns. So that was the first thing I just wanted to say, but I also have a question that goes with it. Do you think that a person's intent on creating something is what determines what something is, or do you think that that's the way other people perceive and take in what's being communicated to them artistically, because this is something that has come up in other medium before, where someone makes a film and it's not intended to be, let's say, feminist, for example, mm-hmm. and a reviewer says, oh, no, that film is totally feminist, even if that's not what they intended. That sort of, like, can apply in this case. Yeah. The second question I have, and I'm sending this to all of you guys, so if you guys have any of you guys okay. have thoughts, the second question I have is, while these shows, at least the ones you saw, which is Adventure mm-hmm. Time and the other two. I'm yeah. sorry.
Korra,
Adventure
and
Time.
And Steven Universe. Steven
Universe, right. They all deal with, at least in at least in part, relationships, and that they're not, you know, simple things, and they can be complex, and they can be involved. And the way the articles are written, they're basically making the statement that it's really, really
yes.
not only great, but really important that these things are, you know, approaching this topic, you know, in this way. So my question is, because I haven't seen it, mm-hmm. are these done in such a way that they are for the children or the younger part of the audience that enjoys it so that they can actually get something from it? Or is it actually, is this part of it being written or at least being projected onto, in the cases where it's not clear, for mm-hmm. the adults that just want to see it so that they can find satisfaction in knowing that it exists, even if the children watching the show don't see it at all. Much in mm-hmm. the same way that if you watch a Tex Avery cartoon, there might be sexuality in it, and wolves like whistling and making funny faces, and the kids don't see any of the sexuality, but they laugh at the wolves' reactions.
Yeah, I think that there's definitely things that are adult, of an adult nature, in both Steven Universe and in Adventure Time that are there, but kids aren't going to pick up on it. They have no idea. they're not going to get the jokes. They're not going to, they're just going to think, I'm having a good time, and there are going to be things that they're going to totally understand as a child. But that's the thing about the progressive cartoon thing. It's, these people only really care about appearances. They don't really care about content. They don't really care about whether or not these things are being depicted in a certain way, if they're actually getting a message that is greater than just boxes being ticked off, or like, where did we meet our quota for progressive things in this cartoon? Did we promote positive body types? Did we put in people who people of color? Did we make sure that there were alternative non-heteronormative relationships in here? They only really care about those little boxes being ticked off. They don't really give a shit about what is really being said. But I think the thing that, to me, makes these cartoons redeemable, at least Steven Universe and Adventure Time, is that when they're covering these topics, they're covering it in such a way that they're actually talking about the subject of love itself and not the fact that it's heterosexual or homosexual in nature. They're just talking about the... When they cover these relationships, they're talking about just relationships in general, the nature of love and affection, and that's what's redeemable about this for me. So I don't think it's really being particularly preachy either. Whereas Legend of Korra was very obviously trying to be preachy towards the end and say, oh, here, by the way, here's some more pandering for you. It was very obvious what they were trying to do in Legend of Korra, whereas in these other cartoons, if they have a message, they try and execute in such a way that they cover a large, they cover the topic as a whole. It feels like they handled it in a really mature way. I'm sorry if I'm.
No, it's okay, Rachel. I think it's important that we, as viewers, we can come up with our own ideas of what the show is trying to tell us, but at the same time, we have to be able to respect what the intent of the creators are. I think that's very important, because it is not a good thing to try to shoehorn an idea into a place where it does not fit or does not exist. What happened with Legend of Korra being that there was no mention, no hint, no nothing of any kind of relationship brewing between Korra and Asami all the way up until like the last minute very end, because that it literally came out of left field, at least for many viewers. There were probably some who could sit there and say, yeah, I'd like to see these two characters together, but there was nothing leading up to that point in what was going on. So that is understandable. What it was, while it was still last minute, it was still the intent of the creators to put that in there, because they did and they made it obvious. For shows like Adventure Time, especially having to deal on a level that is not entirely adult, it is a show geared towards younger children and younger and young adults, it shows different aspects of, like what you were saying, of love and how people love, and not all of it has to be romantic. There is different levels of connections between people, such as Jake and Finn, and then there's the, yeah, I'm trying to be romantic because I want to start something, such as Finn to Bubblegum and Flame Princess, and then showing the development of the character with losing those opportunities for having a relationship. But to say that there's something between Bubblegum and Marceline, there is a sense of love there too, but not, I don't think, in a romantic way. To call it anything else, I if you know what I'm saying, like, there's they have a more of a sisterly rival kind of bond, which in more serious context we see developing up in other shows. To call it, I'm sorry, I'm still trying to wrap my head around like how the heck they can to get to that point. But
there was actually something about I think there's an artist on the show. I'm not real 100%, but basically someone on the team who was hinting that there had been something between them in the past, and I think that it's something that is implied. But we're not really sure the nature of that relationship, but they were definitely closer in the past, but that they aren't now.
I can understand that they might have been closer, maybe, because Bubblegum, the land of Ooh has existed for a long time after this post-apocalyptic kind of when this, as it was revealed, a bomb went off, it destroyed all humanity. This is how we got the Ice King. Marceline was a child, and she grew over centuries to what she became. And basically Finn being the only human, everybody else is non-human. It is very possible that there could have been something. I'm not saying that it's necessarily romantic. They could have had some kind of allegiance, some kind of sisterly, loving kind of bond. But that is to automatically claim that it is a romantic relationship. Fights happen, people break up and leave each other. I'm not saying break up as in, you know, they broke off a relationship. I'm just saying that they separated from each other. Maybe they had a disagreement as friends. But that
they're stretching, essentially.
Yes.
Yeah, they are.
Okay, and I'm gonna take my turn. I actually gonna disagree with Panina. No, you didn't jump over me. But Rachel was about to. So I grabbed her by the ankle and flung her to the ground. I'm actually going to disagree with Panina. I actually think that I prefer to invoke death of the author. And even more harshly, I prefer to invoke stupidity of the author. If the author has created something smarter than they themselves are, I think the interpretation that makes their work smarter, I prefer to go with it. Like, to use an example that we covered recently, remember American Psycho? We talked about it, Rachel and Brian. In the actual show, there were stylistic choices made. Specifically, the Patrick Bateman uses a handgun to blow up several cop cars. And it's absurd. He even looks at the handgun. He does this. He shoots the cop cars, looks at the handgun, and does he throw it away? I think he throws it away. It's like, just like, what the... He looks at it, and it's the expression of what the... What? And then there's a situation where an ATM tells him to feed it a stray cat just as a little kitten wanders by. I mean, she may have chosen to put that in there, and then she goes back and says... I actually meant this to be entirely straight. Like, this is, you're supposed to interpret all of these events as to be entirely accurate. And yet she put those instances in, creating an incredible ambiguity, because they're ridiculous.
She wasn't the creator, though. The creator was the author of the original novel.
Well, the author of the original novel, it was even more clearly, like, concrete that the guy was murdering people.
Actually, no. In the book, it's actually made clear that it's.
Oh, okay.
It's actually made clear that there's reason to believe that the person who's speaking, Patrick Bateman, is an unreliable narrator.
And okay, but that doesn't mean he isn't murdering people, but
no, by unreliable.
Rachel,
hallucinating.
This is a side topic. What I'm trying to the point I'm trying to make is this. If she didn't put that, if she put that stuff in not intending to create the ambiguity, and the ambiguity actually gives the movie sort of more of a genius, there's more of a genius to it because of the ambiguity. If she accidentally put that ambiguity in and she was actually intending us to literally believe that ATM told Patrick Bateman to feed it a kitten, then I choose not to believe the idiot who made the work, and I choose to believe the work of genius. That's my selection here. I don't know if it's because she's really stupid and she just locked into something and doing something so stupid that she managed to pop out the other side into a work of genius, or if she is just shitposting her own work. So in that case, I don't think you always have to agree with what the creators say about their stuff. Because I've seen it. I've witnessed it. Some creators are trolling. I kid you not. They are trolling their own work. And if you actually listen to them, they are saying outright lies about their work. And I'm not saying that these are interpretations. Like, literal lies. They will say that the character A did B. When you look at the actual scene and time codes, character A is not doing anything close to B. And you look at that and you're like, well, how do you trust them? Because they may be creating some sort of social phenomenon around their own work by shitposting it. Or alternatively, their work came from some intuitive wellspring of artistic genius, which they can't tap consciously. So they're a blithering idiot in their conscious realm, but when they get into the zone, they create genius. So I say that I think that we can vote death of the author and stupidity of the author and potential shitposting of the author as ways of ignoring creators' conversation about their own work. So I'm going to have to disagree with Panina that we have to always respect what the creator's intent is. Okay, Brian.
All right. So I think that all of that is entirely valid stuff, like, from all sides. Here's something else, then. This is something I was just thinking. One of the people on the team for Adventure Time made an implication that there might have been a romantic history between the vampire queen, or whatever her name, vampire, and the princess Bubblegum character.
Marceline. And,
what?
Marceline.
Yeah, Marceline. I'm sorry.
Yeah, right, Brian.
I'm sorry, I don't watch the show. The noodly people, I just don't... Okay, I'll watch it at some point. But the point is, what if... This is something that I think is also happening, and this is almost speaking also to Allison's point, too. What if you knew that it would, like, drive up the viewership and it would make people go wild for your show, it would benefit you to imply stuff like that was going on when it actually wasn't, and you were doing it just to fuck with people, or stuff like that was going on the show in the canon, and you didn't know, but people treated you like an authority, so you said, yeah, maybe, and then you get, oh my god, I'm gonna go and blog, let me go get my hands on the, I'm gonna blog about it, because, oh my god, they're gay, or whatever it is I need them to be, because that's what I'd like to hear for myself.
So you're basically saying causing their own controversy in order to drive up ratings.
Yeah, and why wouldn't they?
Giggles. I mean, creators are people too. Sometimes, you know, you create something and you're just like looking at it, and you're looking at the people love it, and it's just like you can't resist.
Right, and they're
lobbing the spink bomb. You just can't.
They're eating it up. I mean, they're eating it up. Like I bet in the interview with those people, well, when the person asked it, it was framed in such a way that they were saying, I think it would be fantastic if Marceline and Princess Bubblegum used to scissor each other all the time. And then, what do you think? And then the creator was like, yeah, if that's what you like, you know, and then they, oh my god, I got the official word.
Well, it wasn't the creator who did this, though. It was just somebody working on it. And then they got into it was a whole big controversy, and they said that they would not go on the record as saying that they were, you know, like that. But there have been things that have hinted at some kind of a closer relationship, or at least a close friendship that was there in the past that, for whatever reason, isn't there anymore. Like, for example, like Princess Bubblegum, like I think there's an episode called What Was Missing, and they each have something taken from them that is important, and Princess Bubblegum's thing is the band t-shirt that Marceline gave her. She wears it to bed at night.
Right, the episode with the Door Lord.
Yes, Door Lord. And it's I don't know, it's implied later on.
Well, my point is, before we move on, my final point is, I think we're in a time now, we're living in a time where people who enjoy the work of other people can speak directly to them
Yes.
Because we have the internet. And they actually have influence over them. And then but that influence is a two-way street. So while on the one hand you have enough people on Tumblr or whatever, you know, talking about and shipping Korra and what's her name? Asami. Right? Shipping them together and talking about how they really love that to be the case. And then the folks at Korra are on Tumblr and they see it and they say, you know what would drive up our fucking ratings? You know, people talking about this show forever is if we shipped them, whether it made sense or not, whether it was like a last minute decision or not. And on the other side of that is this idea that where, you know, they could not even, it might not even have been something in the consciousness of the creators, and then the fans are like, I really like this, and then they say, well, yeah, maybe, you know, and then it goes both ways, and they end up having influence. But at the end of the day, the people who win are the people who create the content. And the funny thing is that I think in the context of this specific article, the youngest part of the audience, which is probably the largest part of the fan base, I think, isn't even being fazed by any of this. So, you know, I mean, that was, then that's basically the last thing I'd say about that.
Well, when it comes to the Steven Universe thing, it's very obvious. It's out there in the open. And what, to explain this, the main relationship that they're talking about specifically is that of Garnet. Garnet, there's this concept in Steven Universe that gems can fuse together and become a different entity. And Garnet is actually built of two separate gems, which is Ruby and Sapphire. And they are always fused all the time, so they're always... there's definitely allusions to that being a metaphor for sex or a solid relationship.
Okay. Rachel, stop Rachel explaining. Pininu is next.
Okay, whatever. I'm sorry.
you can Rachel explain me later, but... Okay. Wanting to address Brian's point, and to also address Allison, you know, I felt like I wouldn't have a chance to rebut buts. I will, if I said 100% creator, I retract. I think that for entertainment, it's a give and take.
No, you can disagree with me.
No, I'm not disagreeing 100%. I value your input, and I thought about it in the 20 minutes we've been talking about it, and I'd like to revise just a little. I think that with creators and audiences, it's a give and take. There are instances of where the creators do listen and implement things from the community and put it into the TV shows, whether they happened by accident that inspired the community that wanted more, or it was just something that the community completely shouted out for. Being a most recent example, the 100th episode of My Little Pony, A Slice of Life, basically touches the backstories of the secondary six, I would call it, or what the community itself calls it, where from the fandom, from mistakes such as like the googly eyes creating Derpy or Lyra sitting like a human on a bench, these characters were seen by the creators from the fan pictures, from the fan stories, from the content that's been put up on YouTube, putting these characters together as if to start molding their stories, and the characters, the creators appreciated it so much to the point where they dedicated an entire episode just throwing these main six into their own little things. Like Dr. Hooves, it's so canon now, and actually implementing more science for this pony instead of just it all being magic. So I think there is a give and take. I think a lot of respect should be given to the creators and respecting the intelligence of the audience for when a creator says that something is happening and that something that is not there is not happening. But at the same time, it's it's stupid. I can't think of anything else I'm going to say other than it's stupid if a content creator is shitposting their own work just to try to get ratings.
Well, I think that, first of all, I think it does happen, and I think they're just trying to create controversy and arguments. But I think we really should move on.
No, God damn it, Allison. I'm going to finish Rachel's planning, and I'm going to finish my goddamned point, and you're going to sit there. Hold on. It's only going to take 2 seconds. Jesus Christ.
One, two, bye.
No. It's only going to... Okay, the reason why I was trying to explain the relationship in Steven Universe is because to address the exact thing that you're talking about in terms of fan creation, this couldn't have been that... this couldn't have been something that was added in after the fact, because you actually look and there's Easter eggs in the background hinting that this relationship was a thing and that Garnet was a fusion the entire time from Dan.
Okay. So we're gonna move on to the next article. Thanks, Rachel. But guys that are listening, by the same logic, and I think that it could be an allegory for sex. When Goten and Trunks become Gotenks, they fucked. So,
Our creators shitposting their own show? This show sucks and you shouldn't be listening to it. Seriously, it's just fucking, I can't even.
What show?
What show? What? This is just a conglomeration of Nerf balls hammering at each other. I don't even know why you're listening now.
The community is already rallying together. Taking some suggestions about what's going on with this cast right now, this panel, and seeing who fits in. Okay, I'm going to shut up.
All right. Yeah, okay, let's... Brian.
So, yeah. All right, so now we're going to go ahead and look at the recent things going on with Gawker, and we'll turn to Hannah to do the thing for the Gawker thing. Hannah, if you don't mind.
Alrighty.
And welcome to the show.
Thank you. Alright, so I looked at this earlier this morning, and for some reason, there it is. For some reason, it wasn't going to come up on my screen now. Gawker Media badly miscalculated reader response when editors approved running a story which was nothing more than an assist in a male porn star's blackmail scheme. The story, which ran on July 16th, was subsequently removed from the site following backlash from readers and pretty much everyone else who heard about it, including some groups who had previously taken issue with Gawker's unethical practices. This past winter, Gamergate responded to said practices with a loosely organized campaign, sending complaints to the Federal Trade Commission about misleading use of advertisements disguised as site content, a practice known as native advertising, and emails to Gawker's advertisers about the company's history of privacy breaches, yellow journalism, and abuse. That campaign resulted in new FTC regulations and an updated policy and seven-figure financial loss for Gawker. The recent controversy spurred users of the Gamergate hashtag and Reddit's Kotaku and Action subreddit to fire off another barrage of emails to advertisers, this time in support of the blackmail scheme's victim. In the midst of that campaign, advertisers have put holds on their campaigns with Gawker and Discover pulled their ads completely. Editorial employees lashed out against the site's managing partnership for removing the post, though founder Nick Denton disclosed that leaving the post up could have resulted in another seven-figure advertising loss for the company. In protest of the removal, executive editor Tommy Craggs and editor-in-chief Max Reed have both resigned, and several of the conglomerate's blogs have gone dark. With the email campaign still in progress, there's no telling where the story will end, but at present, Gawker Media appears to be in the process of self-destructing. And I would also like to point out that Max Reed, I wrote about Gawker's foray into doxing a few years ago when they doxed Violent Acres. Max Reed was not the writer who doxed Violent Acres, but he was the writer who lit the spark that set Reddit on fire to have Violent Acres doxed. by writing the first story about fusking, which was the practice of digging into people's photo bucket albums, private photo bucket albums, to get their nudes out of the photo bucket albums. He wrote about that. There was a subreddit that was dedicated to that, and got SRS all Twitter-pated over it, and then nothing was done. They like switched over from that to a completely different set of voyeuristic subreddits and completely ignored that from there on out. That was the only purpose, it seems, of the article, was to get them set off in the first place, and then they ignored it after that. So the guy that sort of triggered the beginning of the end of Violent Acres is now gone from Gawker. And I'll hand it over to you, Brian.
Thanks, Hannah. The only thing I wanted to add to it was in the memo, this is what stood out for me, was because there was a lot of like talking back and forth and people trying to put out fires, you know, while this was going on. But there was a great bit in there where Andrew Gorstein wondered openly in a partnership meeting why Sam Bring Back Bullying Biddle had not been fired. And that was... It was the last thing I wanted to comment. So it looks like they're, I don't know, they appear to be, there's a little bit of infighting going on. And this is, I don't know, is it justice?
There seems to be a lot of infighting going on, actually.
Yeah. Well, I'm down.
No question. Does Gawker take itself too seriously?
Yes, absolutely.
Because it sounds like that's the problem right here. I mean... I don't even think, correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't even think that, oh goodness, who's the guy in, okay, I'm just really terrible with names, people, and I apologize. He's the guy who was crying on a stream.
Oh. It's not Jordy Tate, is it?
No, he's part of Gamergate. He has a really big news blog, and I really should know his name, but it's in a part of my brain that I can't access at the moment.
I'm sure the chat will tell.
Ralph?
Yes, the Ralph Report. Yes, I knew it was. I was going to say Randy, and I said to myself, no, that's wrong. I'm just going to look like an idiot, so why don't I look like a different sort of idiot? But anyway, yeah, he doesn't, correct me if I'm wrong, but he doesn't seem to take himself too seriously. Am I wrong?
No, I don't think so. The Ralph Retort knows that he's kind of a rag, and he basically, like, it's like, understood. Gawker is really good at trying to fool tricking the public into believing that they're serious.
Was it like Gawker?
Oh, no, they are absolute tabloid trash of the lowest possible caliber. They do take themselves way too seriously, but I don't think they have very many people convinced, aside from the readers of the Jezebel blog. I don't think they have very many people convinced at all.
Can I add a little supplemental in here for this topic?
Do it.
There's actually another article up that I think is really relevant, and I'm kind of glad we got on this topic because I've had some commentary on this over the past few days, and I was kind of engaged in a little Twitter back and forth discussion on this with Kathy Young yesterday. But Nick Denton had commentary on all of this as reported in New York Mag, and it's a pretty short article, but I'll try to get through it as fast as I can. The article is, Gawker's Nick Denton says, "This is not the company I built." Staffers disagree. The dispute between Gawker Media staffers and founder CEO Nick Denton, along with the rest of the company's managing partners, deepened on Monday afternoon, with Denton saying of the current controversy, "This is the very, very worst version of the company. This is not the company I built." Earlier in the day, Gawker Media executive editor Tommy Craggs and Gawker.com editor-in-chief Max Reed announced they were resigning following the partner's decision to take down a post about a media executive who is married to a woman attempting to hire a male escort. New York's Gabriel Sherman reported that during their farewell meeting, Craggs told staffers, "This is Nick's Reichstag fire." A source explained that Craggs and Denton clashed in recent weeks over Gawker's long-term direction and alleged that the founder hopes to transform the company into an edgier version of Vox. Denton held his own meeting with Gawker's editorial staff several hours later. Full disclosure, I was formerly employed by the Gawker site Jezebel. According to Capital New York, he said he still believes it's acceptable to expose the sexual orientation of public figures in certain instances, but he can't think of an outing more egregious and poorly handled than the post in question. I don't want some guy blowing his brains out and that being on our hands, he said. Denton also criticized the editors for failing to protect the Post's author, Jordan Sargent, who is shell-shocked after receiving torrents of online criticism. It's the responsibility of the company, and it's the responsibility of the editors to protect their writers from that shitstorm, he said. Denton went on to criticize the staff for adopting a maximalist interpretation of editorial freedom. He clarified some of his reported remarks in a G-chat with Capital on Monday evening, saying, "What I can't accept is an unlimited and subjective version of editorial freedom. It is not whatever an editor thinks it is. It is not a license to write anything. It is a privilege protected by the Constitution and carrying with it responsibilities." Denton acknowledged that clashes with remarks he's made in the past, saying, "I've been told that there's a lag. Some of my ideas from 7 years ago are still being treated as sacrosanct when I've actually moved on." Interestingly, Steve Huffman, the CEO of Gawker's longtime foe Reddit, expressed a similar sentiment last week, saying, "Despite what users think, the founders never intended the site to be a quote-unquote bastion of free speech." As for his supposed desire to voxify Gawker, Denton said, "Nah, Vox is already Vox. Gawker will be Gawker. Our explainers will be juicier and stories bolder." Gawker Media Executive Futures editor Tomi Skoka, I think that is, returned the volley, telling the Washington Post's Eric Wemple that Denton's remarks at the meeting were pretty annoying and crappy. He explained, "Nick got up and tried to express his belief that this was anything other than him freaking out about Twitter, and he offered some historically dubious claims about his own record and journalistic priorities that people were able to challenge on the spot." He added, "There was a lot of dispute in Nick's analysis, and we disputed it." Denton suggested during the meeting that Gawker should have a written editorial policy that explicitly states that stories must be newsworthy, not just true. Skoka disputed the idea that Gawker hasn't been following that standard, saying, "If you don't think Tommy Craggs has been producing interesting and meaningful content, you haven't been reading the site." Skoka said, "Gawker staffers also questioned why Denton didn't kill the story about the media executive himself. Nick has been aware that this story was going up, and so the idea that the story was so identifiably reprehensible is given the lie by the fact that Nick was aware the post existed and didn't exercise the publisher's prerogative to pull it," Skoka said. Denton said Wemple didn't read the story before it went up. "I haven't read a story prior to publication since Tommy took over," he said. "He talked us through it. I told him I didn't see the point." Gawker's remote editors are flying in for another hands-on meeting on Tuesday, so tune in tomorrow for the next dramatic installment. So, the reason I took the time to read that out is that I thought it was really interesting in that Nick's priorities with Gawker are really, really clashing with his staff. And my general opinion as a journalist is that I believe that Nick Denton made the right call. Could he have called it better? Yes, absolutely. If it were me, I would have not ever let that run. In fact, in the discussion that I was having yesterday, someone was like, "Well, you don't know," and all that, trying to pull that stuff. "Well, you don't know. You're not in his position." I said, "Actually, I was the front page editor of the site that I was on. No story went out without my okay. If I saw that stories were just, you know, a factual mess and didn't line up, I wouldn't let people run it." And Nick Denton is put in this position, especially with the Hogan case and what we've been seeing, that he doesn't need another lawsuit on top of his head. They do not need that right now. And he's got to make this decision that's a difficult one where, you know, someone could lose their jobs over this simply because, you know, Gawker ends up losing so much money that they simply couldn't even support the current staff that they have. The way I see it, it's a multifold decision. I see that it's one, it's a business decision. Two, it's trying to save them from yet another court case, which someone would have absolute justification, and I can cite the laws behind that. It's actually referred to as publication of private facts. In that, regardless of what Nick said there, no, actually, you don't have the right to run off and out someone's sexuality or jump into their sexual activities unreasonably. That's actually something that is protected to an extent under the law, and even a few states have like codified laws behind that stuff. So when it comes to freedom of press, you have freedom, but your freedom of press does not give you authority to trample over someone else's rights. It always just kind of comes back to something I've heard the Amazing Atheist say over and over again, is that your rights end where mine begin. And with what Nick is doing here, you know, it's a tough call. You got to piss people off. But at the end of the day, I think that the writers at Gawker are failing to realize that they exist in a business. Their business is in telling stories, and they sell journalism. I say that as loose as possible, but you kind of get what I mean. And in this case, the boss had to sit down and say, this is something that hurts our company. Not even just the, you know, not even the individual in question that the piece was about, but it would cause immense harm to their company in ways that I don't think that people are processing.
No, I think part of the problem is Gawker's definition of journalism. I mean, the things that they think are newsworthy include Hulk Hogan's dick, Kate Middleton's boobs, Lindsay Lohan's ass, and the real-world identity of a Reddit mod, supposedly justified by the fact that some other Redditors didn't like him. I mean, if they get any closer to the bottom of the barrel, they're going to be getting splinters.
Well, out of the bottom of the barrel.
Yeah, it'll be out of the bottom of the barrel.
Whatever's underneath the barrel, I assume some muck.
Yeah, some pretty sick muck. But the thing is, this is completely consistent with what Gawker has been, contrary to what Denton says. This is what Gawker is. This is what they do. This is how they behave. This is who they are, and this is their definition of journalism. They just found out with this story how far is too far, and what people will or will not put up with, and what level of harm they can do, and the fact that when somebody isn't already massively disliked by the general public, doing damage to his life actually does damage to Gawker too, and I think that they're smarting from that, and I think that they're probably scrambling to try to find excuses. And that was the excuse that he came up with. But I don't believe for a minute that this was not a direction that they would have gone if they had thought that people would accept it. And I would also like to point out that this shit is what Reddit's administrators consider journalism. The same administrators that banned a site full of articles and advocacy for male victims of domestic violence, male rape victims, boys having problems in school that need better education and things like that. That's not journalism to Reddit's administrators, and they've actually threatened the moderators of the men's rights subreddit for allowing links to A Voice for Men. But even when one of Reddit's own was damaged by Gawker, they wouldn't ban links to Gawker.
Okay. Yes, go ahead.
Sorry. One quick thought on that. Just looking at that stuff, and the situation, just as Hannah was describing, was really, really looking at this situation and drawing the comparisons to things that have happened previously in Gawker's past. We know that they've run stories before that have drummed up controversy and other stuff like that. But what I did was I really sat back and looked at this, and I said, they've run some crazy shit before, and they didn't back down from it, and you know, they maintain freedom of the press and all that other stuff. this is like one of the few times in the history of that company that they've pulled an article. And if people didn't know, just to, again, give them context, I think that Nick Denton understood the implications of what was happening here. I truly do. If people didn't know, Nick Denton is openly homosexual, and he's, you know, married, he has a husband, and all of that. And I think that potentially maybe one of those things could have been the factor in him looking at this and knowing what that would be like and all that other stuff. That's just me thinking out loud on how I kind of saw this, and I was like, huh, okay, maybe this is something that helped factor into his decision, and kind of a situation of what if this had happened to me, and looking at that stuff. I do think that it's really interesting how at odds he is with his own staff, it appears, as far as standards and you know, journalistic practices and things like that, and how it's just a complete, you know, it's, we got people going in two separate directions here. Like, you've got the writers who are basically inmates running the asylum, and then we got this guy over here on the other end going, no, yes, you know, we run edgy stories and all this other stuff, but there's a line, and, you know, it's a line that you don't cross, and just because you can, to use Jurassic Park, you know, everyone's sitting around talking about whether or not they could, instead of asking the question if they should. And I think that's really where it comes down to. And combine this with Gamergate, all that stuff that's been happening over the year, the Hogan sex tape, and now you have this situation on their hands, like, their credibility is going down the drain. Not that it wasn't, like, already, you know, whoosh, headed down there, but I'm just saying, this is something that does not help. And if the rest of the executive staff is looking at this stuff and they're saying, just like you said, Max Reed, and, you know, how come Sam Biddle hasn't been fired and all that other stuff like that, I'd really love to be a fly on the wall for the conversations that they're having, because it sounds like your company is not in sync with itself, and it seems like a general bad idea at this point, where you're keeping the management and the editorial department separate. They need to be working together to produce the best product possible. Because right now, you've got, well, I'll just say it, you've got fucking civil war happening in your company, and everyone is watching it from the outside, and it's not going to help anyone. Everyone's just going to end up with shot off kneecaps and nothing to gain from it.
Thank you, Oliver. The last thing I just wanted to say is that I think that one thing that I don't think Gawker Media is going anywhere. I think that it's basically experiencing a shift in terms of how it's going to approach media, and that's what all this Civil War stuff is. And one of the things, though, I think the most valuable lesson that Gawker is going to get from this, and in turn, hopefully, more media as this sort of, like, this discussion that began as games journalism is broadening to include all journalism, is that journalists are not served by the people who watch them. They serve the people who watch them and click on their links and stuff. And if those people, you know, get tired of what they're saying, or walk away, or try to sue them in the case of Hulk Hogan, or, you know, or whatever, then that's basically the checks and balances. That's how we keep this controlled. So Gawker is going to have to, it's basically at the point now where it's going to have to either adapt or it's going to die. And I'm not saying that that's something I want, and I still think that, you know, I'm all about anti-censorship, and even with them, I wouldn't want to shut them up. But whatever they're choosing to say, if it's wrong and it's a lie and they're claiming it's the truth, if it's damaging people's lives, if it's taking away other people's, you know, rights, if it's infringing on their, you know, a private citizen's existence, then they need to be taken to task for that. And it appears to be the case that's what's happening. So, you know, but even if it were to go, something else will come up. I mean, you know, all the people who work there are just going to find jobs somewhere else. So we just have to remain steadfast. You know, trust but verify. Always double check your sources. Question them. Criticize whoever. And yeah, just go from there. So.
Okay.
All right. So Allison, you have a piece.
Yeah, it's a shitty piece, but I'll read it out anyway.
I like your shitty pieces. Like your putrid, pus-ridden pencils.
Oh, they're terrible pencils. Awful. Okay. This is a story that happened in January in 2014, but it's making the rounds recently for, I don't know why, but perhaps the others on the panel can clue me in, because I'm clueless. Comics great Alan Moore decided to sign off from online life after challenging accusations that his characters are racist and his stories feature sexual violence against women. As do most feminist consciousness-raising campaigns, but apparently when Alan Moore does it, it's wrong. Moore rebuts the assertion that it was not the place, quote, the place of two white men to try to reclaim a character like the Gollywog, end quote, by pointing out that if everyone was restricted to writing about their own social class, race, and other particulars, that would wipe out all literature from Shakespeare onwards. He also points out that sexual violence is more common than murder, yet comics tend to depict murder far more than rape. And incidentally, I would hope most people realize that rape is not worse than murder. So, yeah, that is a bit of a hypocrisy there. Then Mr. Moore, in his epic and esoteric fashion, takes his fucking ball and goes home, and never to grace the interwebs or media or... I totally agree with him on the whole no press anymore ever in my life thing, because yeah, press. Yuck. So Alan Moore has gone from public life. I think for the most part, he might pop up again, most likely, maybe not, I don't know. What do you guys think? This has got shades of race fail in it, too.
Oh, of course. It's hilarious because Alan Moore is the guy who he's the guy who basically took mainstream comics and wanted to, he likes to experiment. So basically he wanted to elevate them. Not that he wanted to change the entire industry, because he actually is a very big fan of mainstream, like sort of like Marvel DC stuff as is, but he just wanted to play with the idea and make something for adults. He's one of the guys that basically took comics and made them into something that people who weren't paying attention could see that it's possible that these things could be elevated to the status of what we call graphic novels, where you have like adult storytelling with adult themes and ultra-violence, if necessary, language. But more than that, like, you have more philosophical components, things that you're thinking about. The Watchmen is a good example of that. It's probably one of the best ones. And he also did, like, V for Vendetta. So in case you guys don't know who Alan Moore is, shame on you, but that's the stuff he's done. He also did the League of Extraordinary Gentlemen comic, not the movie. And although I like the movie, but it's not the comic. Basically what he was trying to do was he was trying to make something adult. And in order to do that, you have to put stuff in it that some people might not find comfortable. And he did. And it's funny because he was praised for that. But of course, at the time, we weren't as sensitive about that shit as we are now. So I think it was Christmas time, he writes that he spent most of his holiday vacation replying to letters accusing him of being a sexist, rape apologist, misogynist, racist, even though he was just putting those elements in his stories. So, I mean, you know, not anything new, nothing you've never seen before, but now it's affecting someone who many people consider to be, you know, a godly writer in this industry, in the comics industry. And it's just another example of how creative people are being bullied. You know, I mean, he didn't have to give in to it. He just didn't. He's like in his 70s, and he just didn't feel like dealing with it anymore.
He gave no fucks.
Yeah, he just was like...
Well, that's what I was going to say. Like, Alan Moore has never given any fucks. Not really. I mean, he certainly gave enough fucks to try and respond to these people, but... In the rest of his life and the way that he lives his life, I mean, he can literally just... I mean, he's very much of a recluse anyway. So this is really not a harm to him. He's just like, you know what, fuck you guys. I'm just going to go be awesome somewhere else. Fuck you guys. Peace out. He just goes.
He's like a fusion.
He's a badass.
Pardon the pun. Of probably of Mike and Allison's husband and Santa Claus. And then basically just became like a recluse because Jonathan's a bit of a recluse.
And Aleister Crowley.
Yeah, maybe, yeah. And Rob Zombie.
The Patriarch?
You know, this has me thinking, though, there's no pleasing social justice. There's nothing, literally nothing that you can do that will satisfy them. Because on one hand, they're going to sit around, they're going to bitch about there's not enough representation of women and minorities in a particular media. And it doesn't matter. It could be comics. It could be other things. But they'll bitch that there's not enough representation. And then as soon as they start getting representation, they bitch that the wrong people are doing it. And it needs to be somebody else. They'll bitch that characters aren't being made people of color or aren't being made female when they were originally not. And then they'll turn around and they'll bitch that you can't reclaim something. You know, there's just no pleasing them. They don't actually want a fix. They don't want a solution. They don't want things to be done their way. They just want more things to bitch about. You can completely bow down. You could scrape, you know, the ground and give yourself over to them completely and have them dictate to you 100%. What do you want me to do? I will do whatever you want. And then do it. And they would find a reason to be pissed off at you for the outcome. They would find a way to say, how dare you do that? You have offended me. I am going to protest. And that would be it. You could make you could take every single thing that they claim to be underrepresented and put it into a comic or a story at their request, and they would find something wrong with it. You know, they'd probably call it cultural appropriation or something. There's nothing you can do to make these people happy.
Can I follow up with what she's saying there real quick?
Yeah.
Again, just I happen to be reading something that ties right into this topic. It looks like Offworld had run something, and Adrian, I don't even know how to pronounce his last name, Shumiras, was talking about this on Offworld. And just as Hannah's saying, it always comes back to there is no situation with dealing with these people where you win the game, particularly regarding historical accuracy. And what they were saying on here is a bit of white history. In the United States, literacy tests were tests administered to prospective voters, usually African Americans and poor whites. These tests feigned measuring literacy, but the true purpose of disenfranchising blacks and poor whites by preventing them from voting. They were filtering mechanisms created to prevent representation. In games and other media, historical accuracy allows opponents of diversified period fantasy to maintain an edifice of neutrality, quote-unquote, that's just the way it was, and ignore the fact that all representation is political. It uses the veneer of objectivity to mask its true function of filtering out non-white participants. In effect, historical accuracy is the literacy test of fiction. Now, I don't know about anyone else, but this is the stupidest fucking shit I've ever heard in my life. Like, What is it going to take with these people? Look, when I sit down and I read, you know, The Adventures of Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn and all that, and they're talking about Nigger Jim, guess what? Black folks were called niggers in that time. And it would be weird to me if people weren't being called niggers in a period piece set in that time. That's just the way it is. I sit down, I watch Django Unchained. It's a period piece in the Old West where, even though black people were technically free, things still weren't really great, and they were called niggas a lot. Like, that's just kind of the way that it is. In historical accuracy, or setting a period piece, when you sit down and you look at this stuff, that is the way it was. It was the way that it was because that's the way that it was. And when we sit down and we do that historical accuracy, I'm looking at this and I realize that these people really lack self-awareness, they lack understanding of context, and they definitely lack understanding of the bigger goddamn picture. We have to sit back and look at this stuff. We have to sit down and do period pieces. We have to see where we came from so we understand where the hell we're going. And we go and sit down and watch a movie or read a comic or anything, any kind of work that is a period piece. We can sit here and go, you know, oh, my goodness, this is fucked up. But I see what's going on here. Now I see why we don't do that anymore. People tend to forget that if we don't keep things and situations and things that happen in our past, if we don't keep that at the forefront of the cultural mind, we will fucking forget. We do that. It happens. It happens all the damn time. And it is necessary to look at that stuff, to sit down, to talk about it, and go, now do you see why it wasn't a good idea to do those things or why that stuff happened? And we bring it up over and over again. It is absolutely necessary, and I don't have a problem with the period piece. You know, God, it makes me think about, do you guys remember when The Passion of the Christ came out all those years back? What was it, about
actually,
a decade now?
I'm not even a religious guy at all, but I liked that movie. So I bought it on DVD. Yeah.
And it messed people up. No one ever sits down and goes, yeah, okay, well, they whipped him and then, you know, made him carry his own cross and then nailed, you know, nails through his feet and all that, but it's always very romanticized. And The Passion of the Christ bothered people because they were like, yeah, actually, here's what's probably closer to what happened, and it fucked people up in the head, man. Like, even, like you said, even being someone not religious, to think that somebody did something like that to another human being, that it made an impact on people. And that's one of the most important things of our creative works, is that if we sit down and we make an impact and we show somebody something like a little messed up or things that shock or offend you and things like that, but if we get people sitting down and talking about it, even in the making a period piece, creating a fictional work framed against a historical background, if we can get people talking about that stuff, then it's done its job. It's great. If we got people going, wow, that's really messed up. Remind me to never treat another human being like what I just saw there. Boom, fuck it. We all win, right?
Yeah. I was just going to say that one of the funny things about you were talking about Huckleberry Finn, they were talking about, or Tom Sawyer, they were talking about editing the book so it didn't have the word nigger in it, but which was mainly only used to address the character of Nigger Jim. Funny thing is, though, is that the character of Nigger Jim is actually the most noble and kind-hearted character in the book, and the only thing people seem to care about is that the word nigger is in his name, even though his behavior and his characterization, it rises way above all that. Hannah.
You know, it's really a sad thing that they're, in many, many ways, that they're trying to do that. When I remember reading that book when I was, I think, a junior in high school, and my teacher using our discomfort as a, you know, just a group of kids, our discomfort with reading and seeing and hearing that word, because to us we're taught as growing up, even as little kids, that is a slap in the face when you call somebody that, and so here we are looking at a slap in the face, a mean slap in the face, you know, over and over and over again, and we had this great conversation about the insidiousness and the poisonous nature of racism and how it can poison a community against each other and how hard it can be to relate to each other if we label each other and actually use mind tricks like that to dehumanize each other, and it helped me to understand how groups of people dehumanize other groups of people in order to separate themselves from them and set themselves above them and justify being, you know, inhuman to them and using them and mistreating them and things. And it's something that it's a lesson. And I mean, that was really the goal of writing that book. And Zach J is mentioning To Kill a Mockingbird. We did that with To Kill a Mockingbird, too. I had some really great teachers when I was growing up. And we read a lot of books like that, a lot of different books like that. But that was the ability for teachers to have those kinds of conversations in the classroom to help their students understand sort of the darker aspects of the human psyche and how we play stupid tricks on ourselves that keep us from relating to other people and keep us from progressing as a society, that's very important. It's vital if the human race is ever going to, the human species, because we're just an animal really like any other animal, but if we're ever going to progress into a better civilization that doesn't have all of the mass killing and terrible violence that we deal with today, if we're ever going to be able to do that, we have to be able to look at our ugly side and confront it and learn to overcome it. We can't do that if we're too busy burying it under all kinds of political correctness and trying to rewrite history and pretend that things like that never happened and were never commonly accepted.
Thank you, Hannah. And as a side note, if you look at that last picture, there's a picture in the article of Alan Moore. It's probably the last, most recent photo of him. He looks like he's about to go into the mines of Moria. the guy's beard is beyond measure. It's like, oh my god.
His beard is more lucid, cognizant, intelligent, insightful, and wise than every single person who subscribes to these kind of fundamentalist.
I'm fairly certain the man has more hair in his beard than I do on my entire body. So
entirely possible.
That we're going to be fucking cold in the winter.
But do you think that because of the complexity of the beard that it has achieved satiance? Is that, you know, because they're saying that consciousness is an emergent property of complexity. So maybe the sheer complexity of the hair on Alan Moore has become its own satiance.
Here's what I think. I think at night what ends up happening is the beard more or less turns into the BFG, like Roald Dahl style, and like it just kind of detaches itself from his face and runs around piping dreams into children's windows, and you know it goes out and gets it gets itself trimmed up because it's got to look nice, it's got to put itself together, and then it comes back and you know does its night shift and then he's back on his day job of hanging out protecting Alan Moore from his fucking commoners.
Oh wait. Maybe he has a little beard suit while it's at it.
You have to toss me. Cannot make the distance as you toss me.
But in all seriousness, Alan Moore is a brilliant, brilliant writer. And he did an incredible job of taking comics and removing, or not helping to remove, because comics are something that everyone can enjoy. But I remember just reading about Watchmen and V for Vendetta and how, for him, it was a form of sophisticated comics for adults, for the discerning reader, you know, moving up for the adult crowd. It's no different than when we sit down and watch something like, say, Heavy Metal, you know, where that is specifically an animated film, not for children. I think people tend to confuse the medium for the appropriateness to the audience. The medium doesn't matter. It always comes back to the content, and the stories that Alan Moore has produced did a great job of, well, just as Brian said, making a graphic novel. It's a novel with a lot more pictures attached and adding that nuance and making it a visual feast for your eyes. And, you know, to see Alan Moore, of all people, get run out is something that we don't want to see happen because he's, quite frankly, one of the finest writers and storytellers of our time.
Well, wherever he is, I'm sure that he's enjoying roaring fires, malt beer, red meat off the bone.
I knew he would do it again.
Okay, all right.
Sure you're going the wrong way around.
I'm just saying, okay. You gotta hold up. He's gotta go fight a fucking Balrog, so that's why he stepped out. He's got shit to do.
Why go around a mountain when you can go under it? Alright, so I'm gonna read the short articles. I think that's all that's left are the little stories. And I'll go ahead and deliver those. Well, there's another one? Did I miss one?
No, I was thinking a little bit, you know, impactful.
Well, no, they're important. They're just not as massive.
All it's right. not the size of the article that counts. It's what
it's the content. it's the you know, the good... Okay, all right, let's just do this thing.
All right. So, in case you guys don't know, Ian Miles Chong has made an apology to Total Biscuit. In another surprising turn, Ian Miles Chong confessed to harassing vocal Gamergate proponent Total Biscuit, saying, "I am one of the people who sent Total Biscuit harassment over GG stuff last year. I deeply apologize. I hope that he sees this." And I think Total Biscuit got it, because a lot of people retweeted it and tried to direct him to it. And good on you, Ian Miles Chong. I have to say that such integrity is rare and unusual, and I'm glad that you came forward and said those things. That's good. That means that you're mature, and I commend you for that. Does anybody have any thoughts about Ian Miles Chong's comment before I move on to the next little thing?
I actually think it's just kind of sad where integrity is actually a rarity.
Yeah, well, people get hung up on being right more than trying to glean new information or maybe grow as people. And I don't know where that comes from, but it's like the more people argue about something, the more committed to their argument they become and the less open to ideas. And I think that's that. And then maybe there's something impersonal about the internet that makes it even harder to try to like empathize or understand another person's point of view or accept that you may not have all the facts. But it is a little bit sad. Like, well, this kind of segues into something else. I was at GG in Chicago, and I met a lot of fantastic people there. And if any of you guys are watching, hello. You might remember me. I was the annoying guy that kept saying that he did a radio show, and I gave you a business card. And not all of them were Gamergate supporters. There were some neutral people. There were some people who weren't even, didn't know anything about Gamergate, and they were just there to support their significant others or friends. And I got to talk to them. And, you know, the more that we, and it wasn't like I didn't go there with the intent of getting people to see that point of view, but they were curious, and I talked to them and engaged them in conversation, and there's something about being right in front of someone and speaking right to them that actually makes people more curious. So they started to, you know, there was one woman that was talking about how she doesn't know anything about Gamergate because she doesn't play any video games, but she's gotten into disagreements and debates with people online over mainstream media and, like, stuff dealing with, you know, the elections that are coming up here in the States and Donald Trump and shit that he said and the Young Turks and so on. And I talked to them, and I basically said, well, ultimately, Gamergate is about that, you know, because it's affecting all of us, even if it's not just games. And it really just, you know, it was a really good thing that we had talked about that. So, I don't know, there is, people, like Hannah just said, there's something territorial, and I think that about people's ideas, and I think that's right. There's a territorial instinct to guard your truths, and the more cognitive dissonance you experience, the more painful it is to try to shake that, because it generally really hurts. So, Hannah, you can go ahead, and you said you wanted to mention Mediagate, please.
Yeah, where hashtag Gamergate is mainly for discussing games journalism, hashtag Mediagate is pretty much the same thing with respect to journalism, only it is with respect to overall journalism. It's a hashtag in which the users are discussing corruption in journalism, and they're discussing like news stories getting sort of covered up, things that are not being reported because they don't suit the political ideology of the mainstream of the press, the establishment press, relationships that are not being disclosed and things like that. Basically the same things that are going on in hashtag Gamergate. And so I just wanted to point out that it's there. And it's always open to anybody to post in it, just like Gamergate is. And I would love to see Gamergaters who spot that kind of stuff outside of games journalism, just in journalism in general, please post it to the tag, hashtag Mediagate. I would love to see that tag become a bigger thing than it is.
You can probably do it by doing a hashtag Gamergate and a hashtag Mediagate. And just like that way, the people in Gamergate will see the Mediagate one and maybe they'll start picking it up.
Yeah, like, I actually do that sometimes too.
Yeah, I think that works really well. So anyway, my final thoughts, yeah. Ian Miles Chong, good on ya. I hope that the people who used to support your arguments don't give you too much shit for it, because you're just speaking your mind and you should be able to do that. Okay, so another story that I just thought this was cool. You might know Yuji Nakajima. He is a pretty active Gamergate guy who his little icon looks like a little pixel man holding up a pair of boobs, and he always says boobs are life, boobs are love kind of thing. And he loves boobs, right? Well, he's making a game, and you probably know about it already, but I'm just going to put it out here for those of you who may not. Yuji Nakajima is making a game, and it will be the most offensive game ever. His plan is to make hatred look like Dora the Explorer. Nakamura might be best known on Twitter as the Japanese man who thinks boobs are life. The game in development is called SJW Riot Troops vs. Women, and is to have gameplay similar to games such as Syndicate. I don't know if you've ever heard of the game Syndicate.
Oh my god.
Yes.
No, he's doing it, is he? Oh my god.
Yes. He even hired a musician to sing a theme song for his game. It's called Troops Go, which is chock full of 80s cheesiness rivaling that of Kung Fury. Go to Yuji's Indiegogo page and see if this game is something you'd like to get made. Hint, it is. Yeah, it looks really funny, and why not? I mean, it looks like it'll be hilarious. And it's called Troops Versus Women, SJW Riot. Essentially, the story is the social justice warriors have finally completely lost their mind, and they're going to go on a killing spree to eliminate Gamergate once and for all. Well, they go into a murderous rage, and Gamergate has to call in the troops to stop them, and it's basically a full-on invasion of people of varying pronouns with different colored hair and assault weapons, and we have to stop them. So, I don't know. It's a silly little thing, but it looks pretty funny. He's also looking to hire artists, programmers, and musician types. So if you're interested, maybe you can reach out to him. He seems pretty cool. I did, and he was pleased with my work. And so, yeah, do you guys have any thoughts about Troops Versus Women?
I laughed.
It was funny, yes.
Looking forward to it.
What was that?
It's not much you can say. It doesn't have a lot of depth
awesome.
To it.
It really does sound funny.
It sounds hilarious, but it's like you can't explain the joke.
We'll definitely play.
Yes.
Yeah,
I would definitely think about playing.
Oh man, I hope they have some of these people as bosses, like different, yes, parodying other stuff from games from the '80s and stuff.
I gotta say, I hardly ever get time to play games anymore with everything else that's going on, but I will make time for this.
Well, since you're asking about video game commentary, which seems to be my forte, I think that just strategically what he's doing there is smart, and I think that the game is going to end up being strangely successful for one reason. The entire experience is built around specifically pissing off one group of people. He knows that he's pulling in an antagonizing angle with the content and all this other stuff. And he's basically hedging his bet on these people don't know when to shut the hell up and not give attention to something that's getting on their nerves. So we saw the same thing with Hatred, and this cat's just going straight. He's grabbing the bull by the horns, and he's saying, let's fucking dance. So I think he's going to end up like doing just fine, because one thing we've learned from social justice is that they just don't know when to quit. They don't even know when to stop digging for their own benefit. and I think we're going to see it happen again. The content of the game, just the very core principle, is fucking goofy as hell. And the fact that he even is putting in Mattress Girl is just a complete mind screw for me.
My God, Mattress Girl! Yeah. Does she have a special power?
I don't even know, but she's carrying around that mattress. Like, heavens to Betsy, whatever she's going to do with it, I'm not sure I want to know.
Maybe she's going to hit people with it.
Like, I think
it's
one of
the... It's a melee weapon that spreads disease.
Oh, God. Maybe she'll rape people on it. Well, is that crass? I don't know.
No. Yes, it probably is, but who cares?
But he's also taken the other approach in a really cool way. Like he's gonna flip the roles as well as one of the stretch goals. So at the end of the day, it does come back to it's just he's having fun and making a game, and people make all kinds of games of different tastes and all kinds of stuff. And I think that there's going to be an audience, especially with the playing off of the like Syndicate angle. Oh man, let me tell you, people who like Syndicate really fucking love Syndicate. Like, you use that, and if you jump off of that and you actually make that work, he might actually have something on his hands here. So let's wait and see.
You were talking about them not knowing when to shut up. I just realized that probably ought to be said the reason that they get so offended by stuff like this, and by accurate portrayals of history, and by accurate portrayals in particular of racism and sexism and other dehumanizing behaviors throughout history, is because they can't really differentiate between fiction and portrayals and people actually doing things to them. It's I can't remember who said it, but it's like the one social justice warrior that said that it was the chick that did the stupid slam poem, said when bad things happen to women in games, it's the same as when bad things happen to women in real life. It's they don't have a filter between I'm watching this happen on a screen and this is happening to me, and it's bad, you know. So they really can't. They can't parse it. They can't. They can't separate themselves from it, and then they have to react to it as if they were just victimized by it, rather than looking at, you know, ridiculing over the top behavior as ridiculing over the top behavior. It's a personal attack on them instead, to them and in their minds, and that's why they have to overreact, and that's why they can never tell when to just shut up and deal with it, and when to not, you know, antagonize and encourage people that are pissing them off.
One other thing I was gonna say about SJW Riot, even if it's not. Like, even with the content, you know, and everything that it's dealing with, even if it wasn't about the stuff, I mean, it's basically like the modern-day Guernica, let's just say. You know, it's very relevant in that regard. But even still, I think that we've been, like, there is a, there's probably a market for something like another Syndicate-type game. There aren't too many of those, so I think that it's also just could be good, even if it didn't have all that, you know? So, that was all. I'm going to do one more little story, and then we got one for Oliver, and then we'll be finished. So, basically, there's a new hashtag going around, and it's kind of like a fun little, you know, thing that people are doing to sort of, like, enjoy the fact that as this Gamergate thing has exploded, it's actually created a lot of bonds and friendships. There have been meetups, there's people that we're going to see again, there's people that we talk to on a regular basis now that we play games with. So, you know, that's sort of like a really good side effect of all this. And so there's a new hashtag going around called hashtag Celebrate Gaming. And hashtag Celebrate Gaming is just what it sounds like. It's people talking about their, you know, maybe great memories, great things. I saw one that I resonated with because I'm a big fan of video game music. And there are people talking about their favorite soundtracks mostly from like 8 and 16-bit titles when, you know, let's just say the technology was really limited and, you know, you had to make things really catchy and simple. But these memories, they stuck with me. If you guys want, go on Twitter and use the hashtag celebrate gaming and just talk about stuff that you love about it. See what other people are saying. Try to respond to them. You know, let's keep the conversation going. And it doesn't have to just be, you know, all the criticism stuff. We can also, like, just look at the things that make us warm and fuzzy on the inside.
Okay, is that
yes,
now?
I'm done.
Eating gerbils.
Okay. I have another kind of feel-good story that I wanted to share with people. I'm pretty sure I've talked about this on the Badger Pod with you guys before, but part of the story, as you know, your regulars here know, I've dealt with some hardships in my time in life. You know, the kind of joke is that I'm tempered in flames and forged in hell, and some reason I haven't gone flipping crazy from it. But one of the things that I've talked about in the past, I just explained to people why I'm so counter to social justice and why I'm, you know, against the idea that, oh, it's all these systems on top of your head, then that's why you can't do anything worth of merit. And then, you know, coming out and talking about my own chronic pain and almost dying a few times and being a homeless kid. Something I've been doing for a few years now is, you know, just to give a brief refresher for people that don't know, when I was 8 years old, I was homeless. It was just, again, one of those, it was a situation of, it had nothing to do with, oh, somebody didn't work, didn't have a job, you know, mismanagement. No, it was just bad circumstances that made that happen. And so, you know, as an 8-year-old boy, I had to live in a shelter. The shelter that I lived in was specifically for women with children. And we had a particular caseworker that worked with us. I was a young woman, fresh out of college, you know, early 22 years old, and her name was Jennifer. And she spent a lot of time with my family in particular and just helping us get through this stuff and having to deal with that. And, you know, she spent a lot of time with me in particular, really, you know, cultivating interest and things like that. And it's a person that's had a huge, huge impact on my life. And the man that I am now, she's one of the people that I owe that credit to. Well, I've been looking for her for years now, and I haven't been able to find her. And today, it turned out that I knew someone who knew her already, because it happened to be a relative, and I had no clue that they were attached. And so today I was able, 25 years later, to find her and had a conversation with her today. And there was a ton of stuff that I got to talk about. And, you know, I told her all about you guys and all the stuff that I did with my life since then, and the things that I've accomplished and the things that I've been able to achieve. And how important she was with all of that, and just, you know, helping me to become a man of character and principle and standards, and why I take that time to help other people, because I know what the long-term impacts of those things are. And I was able to tell her today that she, you know, whether she realized it or not, she ended up changing the world through proxy, because she was the person who influenced me as a child, and now I'm a grown man, I'm an adult, and we're working on big stuff. And, you know, just like how we talked about with the FTC and the changes to native advertisement and me having a huge part in that and in making that happen, and all the things that we're seeing and all the wonderful accomplishments and the relationships that have been forged and all that. And I just, you know, got to really finally say the things that needed to be said to this person, and I just let her know that, you know, it's there's always going to be a special place in my heart reserved for her. And it was something, it was emotional. So I just want to use that as a reminder for people that take the time, help other people, and even if you're just doing it to feel a little good about yourself, no, go ahead and do that, because the person that you end up helping today could be the person who ends up changing the world tomorrow. And that little bit of aid that you give a person that you don't think is that big of a deal could turn out to be the one thing that they use to define everything else in their life. I tell you that because I know it happened to me. So I wanted to share that story today.
Well, that was awesome. Thanks, Oliver, for sharing.
Yeah, thanks for opening up like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's quite a gift to do something like that.
Mm-hmm. It was really amazing. Just again, think about that passage of time. Like it really hadn't clicked in my head that holy crap, that was 25 years ago, and to think about how much she's changed, I'm like, holy crap, you know, she's got three kids now, and you know, we're actually going to connect, and I'm going to be able to introduce my wife to her, which is going to be really funny because they're very similar people, and I was like, you know, it's wild that I'm going to be able to tell her children and go, let me tell you about your mom long before you existed. And, you know...
Yeah, she had a life before you were born.
Right, exactly. And be able to lay down exactly where that impact comes in. And talking about the charity work that I've done in my own time and, you know, being able to say, your mom is the reason why this is something that matters to me, because I know what it does for children who have to go through such a hard situation or have to go through that kind of stuff in their life. And if I can use my own life as an example to encourage other people to do that and just show what the long-term effects are, then by all means, I'm going to do so. So no matter what anyone says, fuck social justice, because fuck the social justice warriors, because they don't know what they're talking about, and we cannot create and forge a people that are hardy, stronger, able to endure if we hide them from everything. And I wasn't hidden from that situation. I was aware of this situation, but I was shown the skills and things that I needed in order to overcome that hardship. And this is something that she helped to instill in me. I couldn't be here right now, just period, if I had not been able to pick up those skills and those traits from that person. And now to be able to, as a grown man, put those same things back out into the world. If you ever thought, oh, what I'm doing, this isn't helping, or it doesn't have an effect. No, I'm telling you, as one of those people, I was one of those children. When you hear about that stuff on the news, oh, and there's all these homeless children out in the streets, I was one of them. I know it. I lived the experience, and I'm going to tell you, as someone who now, you know, has had all this crazy, amazing stuff happen to me in my life, and, you know, it's an incredible thing to look at, to go from being a homeless kid to being someone that was in the damn Hollywood Reporter. Like, it matters. It makes a real effect. And just think about it. The next time you see somebody out there down on their luck or is out on the street or any of that, you need to consider for just maybe a minute, maybe it's not because they did something wrong. Maybe it wasn't because they were being irresponsible. Sometimes it's just bad fucking luck that happens to people, and that one moment of kindness will quite literally last a lifetime.
Thanks, Oliver.
Thank you.
I had something to say. it's a real, like, when I went to the GG meetup and I saw all the people enjoying their time, it wasn't just everybody believing the same thing or agreeing, but everybody accepting each other as being human. I mean, even if you disagree completely, you still accept that base level of humanity. And I think that maybe that's the biggest difference, that's the biggest thing that we can bring into the world, is this idea that no matter, people should, it doesn't matter what people believe. And I honestly believe that even the most disturbing belief systems, they're still human on a fundamental level, and we shouldn't ostracize. It doesn't. If we ostracize people based on their beliefs, how is that discrimination any different than any other form of discrimination? How is it? Like, are 200 years from now, are we going to look back at this time and just be horrified that we actually treated people as beneath human because they just believe something different than us, or had different thinking or different logic? So, to pull off of what you're saying, it's really that human connection and breaking down those things that stop us from being able to connect. And part of those things are these entrenched belief systems, these territorial belief systems that we defend at all costs and we prevent ourselves from touching each other and extending a hand out to help each other. And I think, and personally, I think that that's one of the biggest things that Gamergate can change from going to the meetups. All right, anybody want to take it away from that?
All right.
No, I agree. I think that's really the most important thing that you're saying, and I think it needs to be stressed that even though our opposition dehumanizes people and takes away their identities and tries to take away their lives and their experiences and things like that, you don't have to do that. You don't have to participate in that. Be the bigger person. Even when it's someone that you cannot stand and you cannot, you utterly disagree with, and you're like, you're a full-blown Looney Tune in that sense, they're still a person. They're still human. And even I have been through some things that I would not wish on another human being on this planet, no matter how much I hated them. Like, we have to maintain that, because if we don't, it doesn't make us any better. It makes us just as bad as they are. And so no matter what, maintain that human angle. Just as I've talked about on a previous Badger Pod, sometimes some of these people are there because they don't know where else to turn. And they're trying to find some form of acceptance, or they're trying to find some form of healing for things, terrible things that may have happened to them. You know, we see that kind of stuff happen all the time out in the world, where someone suffers an unfortunate fate of some kind, and they'll turn to anything that makes the pain just a little less. I mean, even we see people turn to substance abuse, you know, becoming drug addicts or alcoholics, or they fall in with a bad crowd. They're trying to solve a problem. And it's important to us to be able to go, hey, there are other ways, more constructive ways to perhaps solve those problems instead of lashing out at everyone and everything, including yourself. And if you find that thing and you're able to connect with that person and get them to see what they're doing and make them realize that impact, don't forget to bring your sympathy with you. I didn't say empathy, but bring your sympathy, because life is hard and it's very, very difficult. No matter how much money you have, you always are going to have a problem. Whether you're the poorest person on the planet or you're the richest person, someone's always got some crap that just sucks that goes on. And that's the one thing that kind of binds us together, is the fact that we're all going to have problems and we're all going to face some sort of hardship. And if we can connect with people in that way, I think that we can find some sort of common ground and hopefully find a common level of peace. Wow. Let me take my Gandhi ass over here into another corner. Go ahead, Brian.
Oliver. Wow.
So I be saying good night to people now.
God damn it, Brian, you had one job.
God damn it, Rachel, you had one job, and that's to say that you don't say that people have one job.
Good night, everybody. We're gonna close the show.
Well, is there any last minute things that we need to like inform people about? Any shillings, anything like that?
Okay, everybody, do you have any shills that you need to do? Now would be the time.
No.
Okay, going once, going twice. Okay, shills closed. All right. To everybody who's listening, Badger Pods and Honey Badger Radio happens because of support from listeners such as yourself. So if you want to see us continue, you want to see us expand our message of true love and trolling, then please consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/honeybadgerradio. That's Patreon with an E /honeybadgerradio. Oh, okay, go ahead, Anna. Mention it.
All right, I wanted to mention the upcoming GG in Atlanta and GG in Marietta, and the premiere of the Sarkeesian Effect coming up in Georgia. And it's not this coming Saturday, but next Saturday. And if you check the hashtags, the times for it will be for the two. GG in Atlanta is the day before GG in Marietta. They're both in Georgia. I hope I'm remembering the second town correctly. And the premiere of the Sarkeesian Effect is the night of GG in Atlanta. And I am going to try to hit all three things. I believe I should be able to do all three things because the Sarkeesian Effect is going to be playing. I guess the whole thing is going to take place in the theater. And then of course, I'll be at GG in Marietta, which was set up by Zen Men. So that's the 31st of July and the 1st of August.
All right. Thank you, Hannah. And I'll return to my shilling. where was I? Okay, so we get support from viewers like yourself, so it's www.patreon.com/honeybadgerradio, or you can give a one-time donation at honeybadgers@gmail.com. Everything helps to keep the platform going and keep the voice of, I guess, something. What is our voice? Voice of reason, perhaps? Voice of craziness? Voice of chaos?
Just the voice of the dwarves!
Oh.
Yes!
You feel the hospitality of the dwarves? Go on, Maddie. All over.
Oh God!
Misty,
the podcast button too.
Two dungeons.
All right. So yeah, no, we are the voice of reason and allowing other people to have a voice, even if they have less reason or different reason.
Oh, we shouldn't judge.
No,
they're differently reasoned.
Doesn't matter. Like
they're trans reasoned.
It transcends reason with good reason.
Okay. Oh,
I did forget one small thing. I'm sorry. This is really fast. Did you guys see that William Usher put out a new article regarding feminist frequency and the proof of 501c3 status?
Oh, I thought that was just old stuff, though, from the whole artist that she scammed.
No. This is new. New stuff that came out. William Usher and I worked on this one for about a month. The actual emails have come out and the conversation that was had. And I just happened to see someone mention it in chat off to the side there. Essentially, just what ended up happening is that she repeatedly asked for proof of that nonprofit status, and they refused to give it. They even had their attorney, so-called, basically ducking the question as much as possible. So as the person in the chat said, you are legally obligated as a nonprofit to provide that information to a member of the public should they ask for it. That is part of your tax exemption benefit, and that's one of the responsibilities that you have to do, is that you do have to offer that level of transparency. Since that incident has gone down, if failure to provide that information occurs, a set fine and then a rolling $20 fine every single day that you do not provide that information to that person. So currently, it looks like Feminist Frequency is sitting at around a $17,000 potential fine from the IRS for failure to fulfill that obligation to the public. As someone in chat was saying, that you can, in fact, file that report with the IRS. If you just jump over to the IRS's site and you feel that you want to go ahead and do that, you certainly can. The forms are available there. So just irs.gov and you should be able to find it.
Oh, sneaky fuckering. Oh my god. I guess there are laws. You're not supposed to break them. Okay, I had an idea. Reason is a merit-based system. Therefore, some people are higher level, like not like better, but they just like have a character that's leveled up. in the reason-based yeah. system. Yes, there you go. Well, so we gotta help the noobs. We gotta help the noobs.
We leveled up a lot.
Or they put more points into it.
Yeah, exactly. So all right. Die. Okay, so I am going to make sure that the shill is the last thing, and then you're gonna click off. Okay, Brian?
Yes, sir.
You got this coordinated.
Cut it off, Brian.
Well, no,
right. So we're done.
Brian.
Salted pork.
www.